Good morning, everybody. Happy Sunday. I think we'll begin our service today. Welcome to the second Sunday in Lent as we remember God's ultimate sacrifice of sacrificing his only son, Jesus Christ. And our praise and worship song for today is called God So Loved, and it reflects the John 3:16 verse of God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whoever shall believe in him shall have eternal life. So if you will join me in singing today, I would really appreciate that. If you're able to stand, if you feel called to do so, please. Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy, come to the table he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Sing, oh, oh, sing, oh, oh. So bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. You see his open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved the world. Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, praise him, for the wonders of his love. Let's sing that again. Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, praise him, for the wonders of his love. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. We're walking in freedom, for God so loves, God so loved the world. So bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world. Amen, amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Danielle. You may be seated. Thank you. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Good morning to those worshiping in person with us this morning and those on Zoom and Facebook Live. Announcements. So we continue to have Pastor Don's Bible study, Facebook, and that's weekly. Our treasure shop on Saturdays at 10 a.m. We have our ESL classes on Mondays and Thursdays at 6:30 p.m. Sundays after worship, we have short Bible studies, so please join us. This month is Irish American Heritage Month and Women's History Month. And if you haven't joined us, it's not too late. We still have days left in Lent for our 40-day prayer challenge. So every day we log on to Zoom at 6 p.m. March 9th, we have our United Methodist Fellowship, United Methodist Women's Fellowship in Fellowship Hall at 11 a.m. on March 11th. We have computer tutorial for those who need it. High school students are helping from 10 a.m. until 2 p.m. On March 12th is our daylight savings time, so don't forget to change the clocks ahead. March 16th, Community Care Pantry we have at 4 p.m. And the 17th is St. Patrick's Day. And March 20th is the first day of spring. On the 26th, we will have our monthly executive board meeting. And on March 30th, we have our circuit rider. It'll be done at Parsonage Hall at 11 a.m. We have birthday celebrants coming up this week. On the 6th, we have Alec Diaz. On the 8th, Keir Lim. And on the 10th, we have N.J. DeArmas. And I see we have visitors this morning. Bob, I know you introduced, but would you like to?
Yes, this is my friend Rose. And
hi, Rose, and hi, Meadow. Does anyone have anything they'd like to share? We have another visitor. We have another visitor, yes. Okay, would you like to introduce?
Dr. Ray Santos from Pennsylvania.
Dr. Ray Santos from Pennsylvania. Welcome. Good morning. Good morning. Let me see if I have any other unfamiliar faces. I know we have some of our ESL classes. Okay, anything, does anyone have anything they'd like to share with us this morning?
Yes.
I think that mic should be working. With the blue.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And this is the first time that I'll make this kind of sharing to the congregation. I'm not used to it, so please bear with me. We were both professionals in the Philippines when we came here in America to try the so-called American dream. Right. So when we came here, it's not a silver platter. And we experience a lot of challenges. And along the way, our cousin here, that's good that he's here right now, she's the first person who helped us during our journey in such American dream. And thanks the Lord. We were able to get the H-1B for 6 years. And in the middle of it, my company, who sponsored my H-1B, closed, folded because of the economic depression during 2008-2007. Yeah. And so what happened when you're not connected to your employer, we are technically out of status. And when you're out of status, our driver's license expired, we cannot renew it. And it's a struggle, not only to drive, but also to look for another job. Applying is really a big challenge. So what happened is that we resorted to work whatever is available out there. If you need a painter, if you need a plumber, if you need an electrician, if you need a home cleaner, you know, we're there. It's like an emergency call. When you call my number, we're coming for you, even with a little experience that we have right now. Then. So God is always with us. And there's so many. And there's so many people praying to our well-being that time. Even my extended family, Pastor Nova. And God used one good company. Even beforehand, they knew that we're out of status. They hired me. They hired me. And for 6 years, continuous service, I worked with them. So, but, you know, during the COVID pandemic, I was the first one to go. I was put in furloughed and eventually terminated because, you know, I was not legally allowed to work here in America. So again, we struggled a lot. And the good news is that even those situations that we have, God always provides our needs. There's always food on our table. And He didn't allow us to have some kind of major problem in our body or in our physical aspect of our lives. And that's why it's an overwhelming for all of us that we experience God's goodness. He used a lot of people to give us our needs to survive, the American dream, the so-called American dream. So, to make my very long story short, after waiting for so many years, officially we received our work authorization. Praise the Lord. And not only that, because after we received our work authorization, I was immediately hired by a good company where I could use my expertise for the past 15 years. Glory to God. It's an overwhelming joy. And last week, another bundle of joy because my new beautiful granddaughter was born. And the first time that my wife hugged physically our granddaughter, because our two granddaughters are still in the Philippines. And this is the first time that we'll take care of our new granddaughter here in America. So I give back all the glory and honor to God. Amen.
Amen. Amen. To God be the glory. Amen. Does anyone else have anything they'd like to share this morning? Pastor Don? I saw your hand, Jane.
I'll be short. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
For those of you that don't know, I'm dealing with stage 4 cancer, very aggressive. Now it's in several lymph nodes around my aorta. So I got zapped Friday, 3 minutes worth. I have 19 to go. So I want to thank you, all of you that have been praying for your prayers. Ask that you continue to pray for me. I still feel fairly strong because I have to do another therapy on top of this. So if I can just get through March, I'm hoping that maybe this time, it's my third time around, that we can knock this thing out. But I'm confident in the Lord. He's healed me divinely twice and healed me so many times with medical intervention. So I'm very thankful for that. So thank you again for your prayers. Praise Amen. Be to God.
Jane.
Job as secretary treasurer to the UMW. So, of course, I get this job. The United Methodist Women are asking for your help. We are collecting bread tags that you find on loaves of bread, those little plastic tags. Those little plastic tags that you find on bread. And we are also collecting the metal tabs from soup cans, pet food cans, whatever. It takes a long time to collect enough bread tabs to send off to be recycled for, we're supporting Danielle's Cares for Chairs, which supply wheelchairs. And another one is a cancer charity. So if you could possibly be so kind as to save your tags and your tins, and we're putting this box out. And if you really have a big bag, I'll take them without going in the box. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane. Anyone else have anything they'd like to share this morning? If not, then I invite the children up for Young Disciples time.
Hello. Meadow, do you want to come over? Okay, hi, Meadow. Do you know anybody here? No? This is Meadow, Nicole, Gabby, Emily, and Sophia. So, do you like books? Guys, do you like books? Do you like books? What kind of books do you read?
Bible.
Oh, really?
Nonfiction.
Fiction.
Fantasy.
Fantasy.
Wow. Oh. So, do you go to the library? Have you been to the library? Yes. What is a library?
It's a place where books and things are quiet so people can concentrate.
Wow, so quiet so they can concentrate. You know, do you know what this is? A Bible, right? You know, a Bible is a library.
Because it has so many books.
Yes, it has so many books. It has, how many do you think the Bible has? Yes.
Like 20?
Yes, more than 20. You know, very good. More than 20. So that's a library. Actually, the Bible in the Old Testament has 39. Would you believe that? Old Testament, 39. The New Testament has 20. 66 minus 39. Hector. Junior. 60 minus 39. 66. I'm sorry. 66 minus 39 is? 27. Very good. Bingo. Very good. So, the Bible has two parts. The Old Testament, it is, and the?
New Testament.
Wow, your teacher in Sunday school is very good teaching you. Meadow, you will learn a lot more too in Sunday school. So there's Old Testament and New Testament. And the Bible is all about?
Well, actually, it's about God and Jesus. The Old Testament is about God and the New Testament is about Jesus.
It's about God's people.
Yes, you're right. It's about God. It's about God's people. It's about God's creation. It is all about relationship also. So the Bible, they call it the book of law, right? It has a lot of laws. Thou shall not, thou shall not, thou shall not. But you know, the Bible also has a lot of love. This is also a book of love. This is a love letter. So if you want to, you know, when I was elementary, I want to read the Bible and I want something that I could understand. And I started to read the Proverbs. Try to read the Proverbs. You know, it's a lot of great wisdom there. Okay? So do you learn anything today? Miss Sophia, what I said, what did you learn? I said a lot.
You teach us about the Bible and like about God.
You learn about stories about God and Jesus. The Bible is a love letter. Basically everything they said.
It's good. I like you, Meadow.
Basically everyone said.
Wow, we have a Xerox copier here. So let us bow our heads and thank God for the Bible, because in the Bible we can know how God loves us, right? God so loved the world. I don't know. That's not the
God so loved the world, he gave his one and only son, to whoever shall believe in him shall have eternal life.
Wow, praise the Lord. Praise God. Okay, let us bow our heads and let us pray. Our God, thank you for this wonderful day. Thank you for the Bible. Thank you because the Bible teaches us things and guides us, and we can know you more through the Bible. And we know that you love us because it says in the Bible. Thank you for all the wonderful people that you use to show us how good you are. And Lord, thank you for these wonderful children in the children and the young disciples' time. May you continue to bless them and continue. May they continue to learn about you and be closer to you and be transformed, so that when they grow up, there will be a lot of people better in the world, so that the world can be a better place for every one of us. And Lord, we give you back the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Joyful noise. Meadow, we have a joyful noise collection. We have a can there, and then you go to the congregation and they will give you, they will offer coins, and we'll give it to the church for mission. You two separate. Go to the other side, the other side. To the right and to the left. Anything. If you have coins, if you have no coins and you have paper money, if you have paper. We want also to welcome Steve Nagy. Our happy birthday yesterday, Steve. Woo! Wow, we are blessed that we have a lot of visitors, and praise the Lord. The Joyful Noise Collection goes to our mission, and it supports Eliezer. We are supporting Eliezer since 2019, and we continue to send him support because we want him to grow more in God's likeness, and I hope that your penny, dime, nickel will make a difference to a person's life, not only for Eliezer, but also for his family. So thank you so much for all your donation to mission through our Joyful Noise Collection. We are going to have the reception maybe in Palm Sunday or Easter. Okay, but it's just canceled, but they are still going to be a member. Miss Elba, Hector, Ronnie, congratulations, Hector and Ronnie, for... And we have also Hector and Ariana. So hi, you can go to Sunday school downstairs if you want to join them.
Please stand if you are able and join me in the call to worship. God's word is the Bible. When fears take hold of us, we can turn to God's word. Jesus is God's word manifested in the flesh. Thanks be to God for the saving word. If you are able, please remain standing for our opening hymn, Tell Me the Stories of Jesus, found in United Methodist Hymnal 277.
Thank you.
Please pray with me. The words and the word. How might we read your precious book we call the Bible? As a roadmap, a manual, a trail of breadcrumbs? As a love letter, a symphony, an invitation to a dance? As we open the book, just what awaits us? Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. The scripture lesson this morning is taken from Hebrews chapter 4, verses 12 through 14. We'll also be reading 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 through 17. No Timothy? Just Hebrews. Okay. For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Jesus, the great high priest. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. The word of the Lord. You may be seated.
Good morning. I would like to request, where's Daniel? Let us pray, because it's the word of God that we are going to study. Let us pray Psalm 119:105. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet. Yes, Lord, your word is our light. Your word is our guide. And Lord, continue to teach us. Continue to be with us and to work in our lives and transform us. In Jesus' name, amen. Last week, we studied three important points about who is God. And we believed as Christians that there are three persons in one God: the God the Father, God the Son, Jesus Christ, and God the Holy Spirit, who are all equally God. Jesus Christ is also fully human. In the Reader's Digest article of Ariel Sitlin, there is surprising facts about the Bible. It was just updated recently, February 2013. I was so shocked about these facts, and maybe you might be too. The Bible is the best-selling book of all time, and we all know that. But do you know that it is also the most frequently shoplifted? Apparently, certain readers grab it before they reach the Ten Commandments. The first book to be printed by movable type instead of being written by hand. Johann Gutenberg probably finished his first printing in 1455 in Mainz, Germany. In the 14th century, translating the Bible into any language other than Latin was forbidden. It was a sin before. John Wycliffe went ahead and did it anyway, translating it into English. 43 years after his death, the Roman Catholic Church actually dug up his corpse, burned it, and threw the ashes in the river to punish him for his supposed sin. In 1631, Robert Barker printed 1,000 copies of what they call the Sinner's Bible or the Wicked Bible. One word was mistakenly omitted in the seventh commandment. It resulted to "Thou shalt commit adultery." That's a fact. 1,000 copies, but do not worry, there are no available copies now. They burned it, especially the women. Is the Bible reliable? Reliable, what is reliable? Reliable, according to the dictionary, is consistently good in quality or performance, able to be trusted. It is synonymous to true, dependable, good, well-founded, well-grounded, trustworthy, faithful, and genuine. Is the Bible reliable? The Bible is reliable because it rests upon and points us towards the Logos, Word, the Word of God, the living Word of God, who is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the Word of God made flesh. Even though we often refer to the Bible as God's Word, it is important not to lose sight of how our tradition speaks about Jesus as the living Word. The existence of the Christian community 2,000 years after the death of Jesus It speaks the power of the stories and wisdom contained in the Bible. Listen to this. Your changed life is the greatest proof of the reality of the Bible. Amen. Amen. Your changed life. I don't want to. Your changed life. My professor asked me in the Bible school if the Bible was inerrant. Inerrant means incapable of being wrong. I remember the verse Isaiah 55:11. My word will not return void without accomplishing what I desire and without succeeding in the matter for which I sent it. The Bible can be trusted because its message has a special power to speak to people of every age and outlook. I want us to remember four important words today. Rest, R-E-S-T. Not the word rest, but the acronym, rest. R, rely, edify, seek, and turn, seek and turn. Rely on God's Word and Holy Spirit for true guidance. Don't rely on the TV, on horoscope. Rely on God's Word and Holy Spirit for guidance. E, edify or encourage other Christians and other people with the Word of God. The Word of God is powerful. You know, we can encourage somebody, lift them up. Seek people who are lost and need God's revelation. The Bible is God's revelation. So seek people and tell them about the good news. And T, turn away from what we know is wicked and evil in God's sight. So if we read something about the Bible and it's saying, oh, and we are trying to resist and we know that God is convicting us, we must turn away from what we know is wicked. Now, what is the Bible? The Bible is a lot of things. The Bible, first and foremost, is the special revelation of God. It is the book of law, but most importantly, it is the book of love. The heart of the Bible is John 3:16. And I hope if you don't memorize John 3:16, you should. This is one of the best verses. The Bible is from, according to Wikipedia, the Bible is from Koine Greek, ta Biblia, or the books. It is a collection of religious texts or scriptures that are held to be sacred. In Christianity, Judaism, Samaritanism, and many other religions. The word Biblion itself had the literal meaning of a scroll. The Bible is an anthology, a compilation of texts of a variety of forms, originally written in Hebrew, Aramaic, and Koine Greek. The Bible is a whole library of books. It is composed of 66 books, 39 from the Old Testament and 27 on the New Testament. This is the canonical Bible, written by more or less 40 people who are inspired by God by over a period of 1,500 years. These texts include instructions, stories, poetry, history, laws, letters, parables, hyperbole, epic, narrative, prophecies, and other genres. According to Mr. Google, Bible is the Christian scriptures consisting of the Old and New Testament. The synonyms of the Bible is Holy Scripture, the Good Book, yes, the Book of Books, the Authoritative Book, the Essential Book, or the Manual. In the Bible, the Word of God is compared to different things like solid food, milk, honey, gold, a sword, hammer, an anchor, fire, seed, a mirror, a lamp, and a light shining in the darkness, and a lot more. Now, what does Hebrews say about the Word of God? Hebrews 4:12, Melissa read, "For the Word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart." The sword. The sword, ranging in size from 16 inches to 3 feet, was the most basic weapon used in battle in the Greco-Roman world. For the first recipients of Hebrews, the sight of a Roman soldier fully armored would have been common, as his primary weapon on Roman legionnaire would carry a gladius. It's a double-edged sword about 20 inches long, strapped to his right side. This weapon was designed for slashing and thrashing in close hand-to-hand combat. In the same way, the Word of God, as a sword, has the ability to cut deeply into a person's inner life. You might say that God's Word gets to the heart of any matter. In this sense, it can be a powerful force of judgment when thoughts and intentions of the heart are not what they should be. Thus, the author of Hebrews uses this image to warn against neglecting God's word by failing to obey them. The first century Judaism and Christianity both understood the word of God to be a force in creation, administration of the world, and the judgment. The word, as indicated by the words living and active, or alive and powerful, must be thought of as static speech art. Rather, must not be thought of as static speech art. Rather, it is a dynamic power that has the ability to change, both in the created order and in individual lives. Why should we read the Bible? According to Brian Maley, the author of How the Bible Works, the Bible is said to be the most influential book in history. Reading the Bible on a regular and consistent basis has several benefits. First, the Bible shows us God's character and provides us God's revelation of himself to his people. In each section of the Bible, we see God's holy, unchanging, faithful, gracious, and loving character. So when we read the Bible, we feel good. There is joy in reading the Bible. Reading the Bible is a discipline we need for us to grow spiritually. This is one of our focus this year, spiritual growth of the church. We can be equipped to do good works and be transformed into God's likeness. We cannot be like God if we don't know what and who God is. So we have to know God more by reading the Bible. The purpose of the Bible is to call us back to God by retelling the story of salvation that culminates in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The Bible is God's love letter. The Methodist articles of religion speak of Scripture as containing all things necessary to salvation. It's in the Book of Discipline, paragraph 104. As the writer of Hebrews states it, it exposes us. God, through Scripture, can help us see who we really are. Scripture leads us to repent and turn to Jesus. The writer reminds the reader, us, that when we hold on to our confession and trust in the Word of God made flesh, we can draw near to God in confidence. We can come to God as God's children. If we ask for the holy blood of Jesus Christ to cleanse us from all our sins, because sins keep us away from God. So if we ask Jesus Christ to cleanse us, then we can go boldly to the throne of God. The Bible guides our lives. Just like what Pastor Don said, just like what Adam Hamilton said, the Bible is the best instructions before leaving earth. B-I-B-L-E. Best instructions before leaving earth. How to read and use the Bible? Effectively. It is impossible to read and understand God's word without faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. The Bible is not for the intellectual people who does not have faith, because they will not understand. We can only understand the Bible by reading it in the eyes of faith. Read the Bible starting with a prayer. It changes everything. Because when we pray, it is now not just reading, but meditating. Read it in the light of its surrounding context. If you're stuck on the meaning of a single verse and you don't understand it, read the entire paragraph that surrounds it. If you don't understand it, read the whole chapter. If you don't understand it, read the whole Bible. We are blessed. Knowing God revealed himself to us through a special revelation, the Scriptures. But this opportunity carries with it a responsibility, like Spider-Man. With great power comes great responsibility. And that is also true with us, knowing the special revelation of God. Now that we know about God's love, about the Bible, about the good news, what then are we going to do? with what we know and experience. Friends, I urge you, read your Bible and pray every day. Pray every day. Pray every day. Please. Growing spiritually depends on each and every one of us. Every day, we need to read our Bible and pray. For your own sake and for the sake of the people around you, read your Bible, pray every day. Remember to rest. Rely on God's Word and Holy Scripture for true guidance. Edify and encourage other Christians with the Word of God. Seek people who are lost and need God's revelation. And four, turn away from what we know is wicked and evil in God's sight. There is a job to be done. And what is that? A word to be preached. A service to be rendered. An evil to overcome. A God to be glorified. And a world to be transformed. Are you ready? All of this is possible with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise. Let us declare our faith through the Apostles' Creed in unison. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Amen. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread. Gave thanks to you. And broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat this. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of this, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Amen. For thine is the kingdom,
and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. All are welcome. to come forward and partake in the communion. Jesus said, "Come to me, all of you who are weary, and I will give you rest. Go in God's love and peace. Amen." Body of Jesus Christ given for you. The blood of Jesus Christ given for you. This is the confidence that we have in the Word of God, that if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all our unrighteousness. Go in God's love and peace. Amen. the body of Jesus Christ given for you. The blood of Jesus Christ given for you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Go in the love and salvation of Jesus Christ. Amen. Friends, brothers, and sisters in Christ, this is the confidence that we have in the Word of God. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. This is the mystery of the Holy Communion, that in the breaking of the bread we become whole, that in the death of Jesus the Christ we have life eternal. Amen.
Amen. The Bible talks a lot about how we use our money, our time, our energy. Jesus, the Word made flesh, is clear. No one can serve two masters. You cannot serve God and wealth. You are invited to give as you are able today, not from a place of fear or shame, but from a desire to serve God with all that you are and all that you have. Please pray with me the offertory prayer. Lord, of all that is, thank you for your word, your words in scripture, and the living word, Jesus. Keep us accountable to your word, that our offerings might be a blessing to the world he came to save. Amen. If you are able, please remain standing for our closing hymn, Lead Me, Lord, and Mel, we will sing it twice.
Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to come to you and worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, we come here today with different burdens, joys, with different illnesses, with different feelings. You know our hearts, you know our minds, you know our problems and our needs. You know the treatments, you know the therapies, the doctor's appointments. Lord, we just ask you right now to embrace each and every one of us right here, right now. Embrace them, Lord, with your gracious hands. Embrace each and every one of us, and may we feel your love. May we feel your power, your healing, your mercy. Lord, we thank you for being with us today, for teaching us, and for enlightening us according to your word. Our Heavenly Father, we ask for your benediction to rest on us this day. Place your left hand on your heart and your right hand in the hand of God. Go now into the world, inspired by the extravagant love of God. Rely on God's word and Holy Spirit for true guidance. Edify and encourage others with the word of God. Seek people who need God the most and turn away from what is wicked and evil in God's sight. And now to him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we could ever ask or imagine, according to the power that is at work within us, to him be the glory, honor, and praises. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. The peace and love of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Thank you, and we are so glad you came. Please come and worship with us again. If you can stay for fellowship downstairs, please. Thank you for our greeters and ushers, and thank you for coming. Gracias. Gracias. Muchas gracias. Dios te bendiga.